Good morning. Kentucky fans, welcome to the UNCLELOU channel. I mean, this is my fifth year now making Kentucky videos, and I'm glad y'all somehow finally found a channel. I don't know why y'all haven't been around. You know what the problem is? I mean, I know what the problem is. I'm giving y'all a hard time, but problem is we play Kentucky in November every year. And let's be real, this is the first year since since the Challenger blew up, that Kentucky fans haven't been solely focused on basketball in November. So, but anyway, welcome to LouTube, Kentucky fans. I hope you guys don't take it too personally this week. I hope you get it figured out before you get too mad and go full potato. And some of you will actually stick around. We have a lot of fun around here if you can get past the butt hurt that you're sure to experience this week. But anyway, nevertheless, we'll start the show in a minute.
I'll tell y'all again, meet us at Kroger Field! UNCLELOU, meet us at Kroger Field!
Release the Kraken!
Y'all again. Meet us at Kroger Field. UNCLELOU, meet us at Kroger Field.
Good morning. It's UNCLELOU here. Yeah, that's right. It's me, UNCLELOU, and I'm live for you on LouTube today. Thanks for watching. Really appreciate it. Get to the phone calls here in just a second. First morning announcements, just a few today. Shout out to the good people over at Lanier HVAC Services. They're good enough to sponsor the UNCLELOU show live. Without them, we wouldn't be able to do this show the way that we do it. So big thanks to the guys over at Lanier HVAC Services. If you live in the Atlanta, Athens, or Gainesville, Georgia area and need some work done on your residential HVAC unit, give the good people over at Lanier HVAC Services a call. Their number is 678-943-1351. Tell them Uncle Lou said, good morning. Yeah, they love it when you tell them that. Halloween tomorrow. You know, I was going to do the 3 o'clock show tomorrow, and I'm just going to cancel the 3 o'clock show tomorrow. You guys know, but both of my kids are still trick-or-treat age. One gets home from school right at 3 o'clock when I normally start the show. The other one gets home right at 4 when I normally end the show. I'm just gonna take tomorrow off from the afternoon show so that when the first one gets home at 3, I can go ahead and start with her Halloween costume and have it done by the time Lou Jr. gets home at 4 and do his, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, don't really know why I'm explaining myself to you, but nevertheless, I am. And so no live show tomorrow. It's Halloween. Go trick-or-treating or whatever it is that you do on Halloween. If you're one of those religious type people, go to your church and do trunk-or-treat and complain about how Halloween is, you know, the devil's holiday. Point is, whatever it is you want to do tomorrow, do it. What I want to do is enjoy Halloween with my kids, and that's what I'm going to do. So, sorry, I'm going to take tomorrow off. We will be live Thursday night at 10, Friday afternoon at 3, and Saturday morning at 9, but I'm going to take tomorrow off. It's just the way it is. College football playoff poll came out today. I didn't get as many right this year in the first poll as I did last year. Last year, I got the first 8 right, and then I had 9 and 10 flip-flopped. This year, I had the first, I think, 7 right, but I had a couple out of order. But anyway, I had the same first 7 teams, but a couple of them were out of order. They had Kentucky in the top 10. I didn't. I had West Virginia in the top 10. They didn't. Ask yourself this. Who would win between West Virginia and Kentucky? Give me a break. Yeah. And they didn't have UCF in the top 10 either. I had them at 10, but I've been telling y'all for 2 months I'm leaving UCF at 10 unless they lose a game, period. So that's just what that is. Anyway, we'll get to the phone lines here. 706-510-6817 is the number if you want to be on the show. It should be scrolling up on the screen somewhere for you. 706-510-6817. Kentucky fans, call up Uncle Lou. Educate me. Explain, help me understand how a team that has scored a total of 3 offensive touchdowns in the last 3 games, not 3 per game, 3 total in the last 3 games, is going to beat UGA. Help me understand. Good morning. You're on with Uncle Lou.
Hey, Uncle Lou. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good.
Okay, good.
I am a Kentucky fan. I'm not gonna complain about, you know, your objectivity about the game. I understand that. But just as a look at the Kentucky defense versus Georgia's offense, how do you think it matches up?
I think Kentucky's defense is legit. I think it's legitimate. I think Kentucky's defense is the real deal. It's hard to compare one defense to another. I mean, we can look at a whole bunch of different stats and see who ranks where. I think Florida's got a pretty good defense. I think LSU's got a pretty good defense. And Kentucky is in that category. Maybe Kentucky's a little bit better. Maybe Kentucky's right in the middle of those two. You know, I know they're tops in scoring defense. You know, I hate just picking out one particular ranking or whatever. You know, total defense, I think you guys are like 10th or 12th or something, but scoring defense, you're first. I might look at somebody like LSU and it might be the other way around. They might be 12th in scoring, but first in total defense or something. So I don't know, but the point is, I have nothing bad or negative to say about Kentucky's defense. Josh Allen does worry me. I mean, you know, every team y'all have played has had a game plan to try to slow him down, and every team has failed. So we'll see. Our left tackle is injured. I'm not making excuses. I'm just saying that's causing me to worry even more. He should play But he's been injured for a few weeks now. He tried to play in a Florida game. He got re-injured. I think he came back in. But the point is, he's hobbled. But it's November. Everybody's got problems with injuries. I'm not making excuses. I'm just saying Josh Allen worries me. I mean, your front seven is great. Your DBs are tall, big, and physical. So do I think Georgia will score 40 points on that defense? No, I don't. I would be shocked if Georgia got anywhere close to that.
Question about Georgia. Is Ben Cleveland, is he playing?
He was dressed and ready to go at the Florida game. Of course, he did not play. I mean, Kirby's trying to get injury information out of Kirby Smart is like, you know, trying to get the nuclear launch codes from the president or something. I mean, he's just not going to give out any information. But the Florida game was the first game that he was dressed out and on the sidelines in a few games. So that was a positive sign. My gut tells me that he will play this week. Whether he can go the whole game or however that goes, I don't know. But, you know, I don't have any inside information. Kirby's not going to say anything about it one way or the other. But the fact that he was dressed out and warmed up at the Florida game, I think, is a positive indication for Georgia fans that he's at least really, really close to being back, and hopefully that will be this week. So we'll see.
All right, man. Well, I appreciate the call. Good luck, and maybe the Cats pulling out.
Yeah, and hey, stick around. I'm going to do some basketball. I kid around about the basketball, but I'm going to do some basketball stuff after the football season ends, and we have a good time on this channel, and this just happens to be Kentucky week, so I don't know if you've been around for a long time or if you're just here for this week or whatever, but we have a good time on here, and you seem like the type of football fan that knows how to roll with the punches, and so I mean, good luck to your team. I'm hoping for a good game.
The bad times.
Okay.
Kentucky football. So all right. I'm just enjoying it.
Good. All right. Well, I'm hoping for a good game, man. And thanks for the call. I appreciate it. Yeah, I mean, I don't know how anybody can really say anything bad about Kentucky's defense. I mean, their defense has been lights out. The obvious issue for Kentucky is offense. And by issue, I mean they just don't have one. Good morning. You're on with Uncle Lou.
Yeah. Uncle Lou, how are you?
Oh, man. I'm great.
Well, I had a question about the Alabama-LSU game.
All right.
Me and my dad got a $100 bet going down.
Uh-oh.
And I think LSU's going to pull one out this week.
Uh-oh. Yeah. Hope you can afford to lose that $100.
No, I mean, come on. Is this not set up as a trap game for Alabama?
Why? Who do they play next week?
Alabama?
I mean, a trap game is typically when you get caught looking ahead to next week. I mean, this is the game for Alabama. There's nothing else to look forward to until they lose to Georgia in the SEC championship game. I mean, LSU is going to be the best team they've played. I like LSU's secondary. You guys are physical up front. You know, I mean, almost everybody wants Alabama to lose just because they hate Alabama fans or whatever. I don't hate or. I mean, I don't really care one way or the other who wins. I have a hard time thinking LSU can pull it off. I do think it helps. It's at home. It's at night. You know, I think it might be a close competitive game. Didn't I take LSU? I'm pretty sure I took. Didn't I take LSU? Yeah. I mean, I picked LSU in the video today with the 14 points. So I'm not sure LSU can win outright, but I'm expecting it to be a good game.
Yeah, well, I mean, see, I'm a big Georgia fan, but I just don't think – I mean, I think Alabama's offense is really solid, and they're probably the best in the country, but I just know their defense is a little weak, and I think it just sets up perfect for LSU.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, when you look at Alabama, they're this year's Oklahoma. Their offense appears to be unstoppable, so you have to start, you know – looking at what happens if this game gets into a track meet type thing. And is LSU capable of scoring 40 points on anybody? I'd have to go back through and look at their schedule, but I can't remember off the top of my head a single game this season where LSU has scored 40 points. I'm probably wrong, but I don't remember a game where they scored 40. As far as I can remember, Georgia was the best offensive game they've had all year, and they scored 36. In theory, a team could play really good defense against Alabama and hold them to what, 35? That would be pretty good against Bama. If you look at the Georgia-Oklahoma game from last year, we gave up 48 points to Oklahoma, but we won the game. I think that's the kind of game, if somebody's going to beat Alabama, that system that they have on offense just looks hard to stop right now.
Yep. All right, well, thanks for the call.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I hope that wasn't your cable bill money or anything you spent that, you betted that $100 on. But surely you didn't bet this game straight up, sir. Certainly you took the 14 points. I'd be awfully disappointed if you bet that game straight up. Good morning. You're on with Uncle Lou.
Good morning, Uncle Lou. It's Big C. Long time no call.
Hey, man. Yeah, how you been?
I've been all right. You know, life has been terrible, but...
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
I'm watching the show and finally got through after a while.
Well, what's up today?
Oh, not much. I kind of wanted to comment on the LSU-Alabama game, like your last caller.
Yeah.
This would be the game for them to lose if there was a game that they would lose, even though it doesn't look possible.
Did it look possible that they would lose to Auburn last year? I don't know.
After Georgia got beat down by Auburn, I'd say so, yes, because it was at Jordan-Hare.
What was the spread on that game? I can't remember. How much was Bama favored by in that game? I can't remember.
I really don't know, because I don't really keep up with the spreads that much.
Yeah.
But,
I'd have to look that up.
After watching the Georgia-Auburn game last year, I thought they had a chance to lose.
Yeah.
But,
What about after watching the LSU-Georgia game this year? Isn't it the same?
Yeah, a little bit. That's why I'm saying LSU has a chance, and they're both on a bye week, so hopefully... is game day going there this week?
I haven't looked it up, but I'm sure that's where they'll be.
That and if it's a night game in Death Valley, we know the statistics of people playing at night that LSU is not good.
Right.
LSU.
Yep, right. Unless you're Mississippi State or Troy.
Yeah. But on to that, well, I kind of... still hoping Alabama still wins. I'd like them to be undefeated and in their own heads when they show up for the SEC title game in Atlanta.
Yeah.
That would hopefully give the Dogs a better chance. But
well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who plays who in the SEC title game. The winner of the SEC title game is going to the playoffs, period. It doesn't matter who they who they beat.
Hopefully Georgia... Isaac Nottis said it best. They were sleepwalking through games.
I know somebody else. Yeah, I know somebody else been saying that for about 6 weeks.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's a good way to put it. That's what they looked like all year. They definitely, I don't even think they remotely played to their potential.
No.
I'm glad they're in Florida, but they still don't look as good as they should be.
No. Now, the bad news is, like, defensively, that's just what we are. You're not getting any improvement there this year. You need to cycle some players in and out there. Maybe we can do some things differently scheme wise to try to compensate for some things or whatever, but there's no light bulb that's about to go off for the defense. The defense is what you've seen this year, which is a pretty good defense. I mean, it's a top 15, top 20 defense, but it's nowhere near the defense that Georgia had last year. And nothing is going to happen this week or next week or a month from now. That's just the defense we have. Offensively, It's been like banging your head against the wall watching this offense. I mean, Chaney, he's got to be hanging by a thread at this point. There's just no way with the amount of talent that's on that offensive side of the ball at skill positions that they should be struggling to move the ball in large portions of games against inferior teams like they have been. First half of South Carolina, first half of Missouri, first half of Tennessee, the entire LSU game. We just looked lost on offense, and that's inexcusable, and somebody has to answer for that.
Somebody needs to answer for why we had 7 plays from the 1 yard line and couldn't punch it in the end zone.
Yeah.
I mean, good God. I don't even know what to say about that. Like, that's ridiculous.
Well, that was just part of the game plan. We were trying to burn clock. You ever seen somebody have a 4-minute drive entirely within the 1 yard line? First time it's ever been done in the history of college football, sir. Kirby is a genius.
Hey, silver lining, I guess.
Yeah, I guess.
We could still go back and you could just watch the mistake that they made, but, you know, they played good enough to win. And, you know, back to the defense, I think even in the LSU game, they played good enough to win, but
they did.
Not moving the ball downfield, keeping them off the field.
Oh, listen, tired. Yeah. There's a certain group of Georgia fans, I'm not gonna call them out right now, who wanted to cry about the defense in the LSU game. Listen, if you know anything at all about football and you watched the Georgia LSU game, then you know the defense played great. How many times did we turn the ball over and give LSU the ball on our side of the field and hold them to a field goal? How many times do we go 3 and out on offense and put the defense right back out on the field in a bad position? How many times did our punter punt the ball 15 yards out of bounds and give LSU great field position? We kept holding them to field goal after field goal after field goal, and as bad as that game was, and it was bad, we were down 10 points with 9 minutes to go in the fourth quarter, and we were in field goal range. And we took a boneheaded sack that knocked us out of field goal range, and you know they scored a late touchdown and ended up winning by the 20 points. So credit to LSU, the point is you're right. The defense played good enough to win in that game, and I think Georgia's defense is good enough this year to win us some games. But I mean, let's be real. This offense should be scoring 45 points a game without trying. We have 5 stars at every single position. I don't understand. 3 5-star wide receivers, a 5-star tight end, 3 5-star offensive linemen. Fromm's a highly rated 4-star. His backup is a 5-star. I mean, how many 5-stars do we need before our offense starts to look like a grown-up offense? Now, I don't want to get into all this again because in Florida we played great. Fromm threw the ball over the middle. He threw it to the tight end. He got rid of the ball quick. He didn't take stupid sacks. He held on to the ball. He looked like he knew what he was doing. He didn't stare down receivers. So Fromm had a great game, and I have nothing but good things to say about Fromm in Florida game. And if that's the Fromm we see for the rest of the year, then Georgia's got some potential to do some things.
Well, I hope that is the Fromm that we see. I want to give a shout-out to Holyfield. I think if anybody's playing hard on this team, that kid is.
Well, he didn't show up in the Florida game, though. But he's had an okay year, but he averaged 3 yards a carry against Florida. That's not getting it done. Swift was the man in the Florida game. Where's he been all year? He finally decided to show up, too. I know he's been nursing that injury, and maybe the off week is what he needed, a week of rest. But he looks like the old DeAndre Swift now, which is good news for Georgia because he's our best running back, and it's not close.
Oh, absolutely. I just want to give a shout to Holyfield because it looks like he's at least playing with his heart. He might not have the football smarts or the ability, but
yeah, no, he tries like hard.
The team should have played as hard as he did.
Yeah, he's played better than I thought he would play. Yeah, he's done better than I thought he would do this year for sure. But hey, thanks for the call. I'm gonna let you go and try to catch another one here and get these calls a little quicker. Couple of super chats I saw come in while I was on the call there from a couple of Florida fans. Shout out to you guys, man. Listen, I gave Florida a lot of hell in the week leading up to that game. I gave Florida fans a lot of hell in the couple of days after that game. And the overwhelming majority of the Florida fans on YouTube are still here. So shout out to the Florida fans, but in particular these two here for the super chats. Thank y'all for the donation. Gator Zoned says, go Gators, woo. and Florida beh. Well, I'm not going to say anything about his screen name because he did a super chat. So thank you for the super chat, sir. He says, "Morning, Lou, and go Gators." Go Gators. Yeah. And Natty back to you for you there. Good morning, though, and too. Thank you guys for the super chats. I appreciate it. Good morning. You're on with Uncle Lou.
Hey, Uncle Lou. I'm a Gator fan. Just wanted to call your show.
Yeah, man. What's up?
I just wanted to say, what's up? I'm actually a high school student. I should probably be studying right now, but, you know, football takes precedence over all that. So, you know, I just wanted to ask you what you think of, you know, the Georgia-Kentucky game. If you're more nervous for this game than you were for the Gator game, or what?
Think?
Because you would think you would be.
Yeah, I'm not.
They beat Florida.
Yeah, I'm really not. For some reason, I just have a really good feeling about the Kentucky game. And for those that follow along with me, obviously I talk trash no matter who we're playing. We could be playing the 85 Bears, and when I make that Friday video, I'm going to act like we're winning by 100. But if you listen to the live shows and listen to me talking stuff during the week, you can kind of get a pretty good idea of where I'm at. I mean, against Florida, I picked Georgia to win, but in my SEC preview video, I took Florida and the points. I thought Georgia would win that game by 3 or 4 points. I was very nervous heading into that game. I was nervous heading into the LSU game. I was nervous heading into the South Carolina game. That was mainly because it was week two, and we played a nobody week one, so I really didn't know where we were at yet. But the Kentucky game, for I don't know why. I'm just not nervous about this game at all. I don't believe in Kentucky's offense at all, not even a little bit. I'm not even worried about Benny Snell. And maybe I'll get into more about why that is in a little bit, but
what about touchdown Terry?
No, you know, interception Terry Wilson. This guy's got more interceptions than he does touchdowns. He can't throw the ball. He can run around, and that's great. But I mean, Kentucky has scored a total of 3 offensive touchdowns in their last 3 games. Not 3 per game, 3 total. This is against juggernauts like Kentucky and Vandy. So the problem is, I'll just go ahead and say it. Kentucky is suffering from Auburn disease right now. Auburn had a really, really good running back each of the last 2 seasons, Cam Pettaway and Kerryon Johnson. And what happened in November both years? They had wore those guys out. Why? That's all they had. Those guys were getting 25, 30, 35 carries a game during the months of September and October. And when November rolled around, they were out of gas. And Benny Snell's the same way. 50 yards or 60 yards, whatever it was, against Missouri. He's out of gas. And the thing is, Benny Snell had 100 yards rushing on Georgia last year. We beat him 41-14. Now, I know Kentucky's a lot better, so I'm not comparing the two. I'm just saying, what's the most amount of yards you think Benny Snell's going to get in this game? Let's say he gets 100. That's not enough. They have no passing game at all. 3 touchdowns in the last 3 games against teams like Kentucky and Missouri and Vandy, that's terrible. I'm not worried. So, like I said, I don't think Georgia's winning this game. I don't think we'll score in the 40s. Kentucky's defense is legit. But does anybody think Kentucky can score 20 points on Georgia? I'm being dead serious. I'm not trash talking. I don't know if there's a soul alive that thinks Kentucky can score 20 points on Georgia. And you can say, well, it's at Kentucky. They got some, you know, they've had some big wins at home. Yeah, big wins where they've won like 13-7. 14-7, 13-10, 15-14 against Missouri this past weekend. I don't remember the last time Kentucky scored 20 points, and it's probably not happening this week. So if Georgia can get into the 20s, and I think they can, they're going to win this game.
Yeah, I agree. But, yeah, what do you think about the Auburn game,
the Auburn's
playing, who they're playing, and Auburn A&M game.
Yeah, that's a tough one to pick.
A&M would be one of the better teams.
Yeah, that's a tough one to pick because, you know, Auburn fell off, they lost to Tennessee, but then they turned around and got a big win the next week, and then you look at Texas A&M, they started off pretty good, close loss to Clemson, and then at one point they were 5-2, and their only 2 losses were to Clemson and Alabama. I mean, that's 2 pretty good losses, but then they lost last week, unexplainable loss, really, last week. And when you look at A&M's history, and I know they have a new coaching staff now, but they've just been god-awful in November for like the last 6 or 7 years in a row. So this is a hard game to pick here. Auburn's a 5.5-point favorite. It's at Auburn. I can probably see Auburn winning this game by a touchdown or something, but that's a hard one to pick because you don't know which one of, you know, which Auburn is going to show up, the Auburn that lost to Tennessee or the Auburn that won after Tennessee. That's a tough one to pick.
And then one quick question. I thought, let's say hypothetically, FSU and they go to the SEC championship. Let's say it's either a one-loss Kentucky or Georgia, assuming Georgia, they went out. Would you say the winner of that game, they would obviously go to the playoff? Do you think Bama gets in if they're a one-loss?
No. I don't think that plan will work.
Notre Dame,
I don't think that plan will work this year because of Notre Dame and because I think there's going to be a one-loss Big Ten champion. I can't see Michigan and Ohio State each losing again. One of those two teams is going to win out, I think. So you're going to have a one-loss Big Ten champion. They're getting in. If Notre Dame goes undefeated, they're getting in. And that's a big if. But, I mean, they don't play anybody. I mean, their toughest game left is Southern Cal. Southern Cal's probably a 500 team. Southern Cal be lucky to finish 6-6 this year. I just don't see Notre Dame losing. Do I think that Notre Dame can compete with Alabama or Clemson or probably even LSU or Georgia or any of the top five or six teams? I don't think so. But if they go 12-0 with a win over Michigan, I just don't think you can keep them out. So in that scenario, you would have Clemson would get in, the SEC winner would get in, Notre Dame would get in, and I think the Big Ten winner would get in, because you got to remember you're probably going to have you're probably going to have a one loss Big 12 champion, and you're probably going to have a one loss Pac 12 champion in Washington State. So Alabama, in order to get in, would be jumping like 3 one loss conference champions, and I just don't think that will happen. Last year, Alabama got kind of lucky because there were no one loss conference champions. All the conference champions except for Oklahoma, Clemson in the SEC were 2 lost. The Big Ten and the Pac-12 each had 2 lost champions. So they put Alabama ahead of those 2 conferences because Alabama only had the 1 loss. And you didn't have Notre Dame to worry about either. I just don't think it adds up this year for a conference to get 2 teams in.
All right, then, Uncle. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the call. I appreciate it.
Have a good rest of your morning.
Yeah, thank you. And good luck to you this weekend. And as well. All right, a couple more super chats came in. Let me scroll through these here, and then I'll get back to the phone calls. Chris Wallace, thank you, sir. I appreciate it for the super chat. Thank you. Seth Stein, $10. Thank you, sir. Last 3 games, Kentucky has scored 15, 14, and 14. Yeah. I mean, they just they haven't looked good on offense, and it's not like a 1-week thing. I mean, their last 3 wins have been extremely lucky. They easily could have lost all 3 of those games. And they did lose one of them, but they could have lost all 3. Tomahawk 238, thank you, sir. I appreciate that. Lou, make a super fan character for the neckbeards. You could call him Uncle Blue. That's a great idea. Unfortunately, it may not look like it because I'm such a terrible actor, which people love telling me that in the comments section, but it takes me a long time to develop one of those characters. The name, now you just solved a lot of my problem because that name is great, Uncle Blue, and the costume would be pretty easy, especially this time of year. I could easily, you know, grab a fake beard from the costume store or whatever, and instead of wearing it like a normal beard, like normal people do, I could just have it all down here. I don't know why they think you're supposed to grow a beard all down here. But there's a lot more that goes into it than that. I have to come up with a whole backstory for the character and a way for him to talk and a way for him to dress and look and all that. And it's just not enough time for me to come up with that this week. And if I did that, Auburn and South Carolina fans would be very, very mad because I have promised that the next superfan character will either be an Auburn or a South Carolina fan. But, man, just the fact that Uncle Blue would be such a great name really makes me regret my decisions here. But you, I think you win for the best comment, Uncle Blue. Chris Wallace, thank you, sir. $5. One QB and one CB away from UGA year one. He Florida man, Lou. Well, the problem is, Chris, because you're talking about Florida, the problem is Florida's been one QB away for the last 11 seasons, according to Florida Fan. And it hasn't worked out. And if you look at your defense, there's some bad news for you for next year. But unless you can convince a whole lot of juniors on defense who I think are going pro to come back, your defense is taking a huge step back next year. And the problem on offense is I don't think you have a quarterback that's ready to go. Maybe Emory Jones can give you something to quarterback position next year, but I'm not 100% certain on him yet. And even if you guys decide to go with Emory Jones next year, that's going to be his first year starting. Wasn't this past Saturday the first time he's even played all year? And he didn't throw the ball, of course. He handed it off, ran it a couple of times, and dropped it on the ground a time or two. So he'll have a learning curve next year, too. Now, it'll help that he redshirts this year or whatever, so it's not like he's fresh off the boat or whatever. But I've just heard a lot of that kind of talk this week that the next year's the year thing for Florida. And honestly, it's starting to sound like Tennessee fans with the next year thing. I mean, it's been 11 years since Tennessee won the SEC. And if I really wanted to troll you a little bit harder, which I will, I'll go ahead and do it, I would remind you that Jim McElwain was a head coach in the SEC for 3 years and won two division titles. Dan Mullen has been a head coach in the SEC for a decade and has zero division titles. Doesn't look good. But thank you for the super chat. And, of course, just trolling a little there. I hit the button too late. They'll call back. Good morning. And, two, you're on with Uncle Lou.
Uncle Lou, let them know who I am, man. You know who called in.
Five-star caller. The original. Man, you're the original. And you're still the only one with your own shirt, too.
Five-star caller.
Yep, I still got it. I actually wear it every Saturday, believe it or not.
I went to Lou Jr. had a soccer game tonight, and I went to the soccer game, and when I got there, my parents were there, and I saw them from a distance or whatever, and they were facing the other way, and when I got up, they turned around, and they both had on Lou Tube shirts. It was kind of embarrassing.
But, hey, you know you're blowing up when other people were wearing your merchandise.
Anyway, are you worried at all about this weekend? This is Ryan S., Alabama fan, for those of y'all that don't know. But so are you worried at all about this weekend?
Uncle Lou, first let's get it straight. Let them know I'm a bandwagon. Let them know I'm a bandwagon, all right? I'm an official Alabama bandwagon, but to be nervous about this game, I'm not going to lie to you, Uncle Lou. I'm always nervous. That's just the college football fan in me. Now, Alabama, and this is what grinds my gears, overcooks my grits. You could use any catchphrase you want to. This season is a perfect example. We've been playing ungodly. Offense, defense is kind of, sketchy in here and there, but overall they're okay. But our offense is on fire. We're having a great season, undefeated. Everything's going well. We do have some injuries, but we're still playing great just because of how much depth we have. But with that being said, and it doesn't matter if we're playing at home or away. We could play LSU and Auburn, whether at home or away. We could be having the best season of our life, and they could be having the worst. But when it comes time to play LSU or Auburn, it's like we forget how to play freaking football. I don't know if it's just me. I don't know if other people have the same opinion or not. But to me, it just seems like we forget how to play football. And playing down there in Death Valley, I know it's going to be packed. So, I don't really think the crowd would take a toll on Alabama. But with them playing tough and against us, I mean, it's
I don't know, last year we had so many injuries playing with them, especially Minka getting hurt. Fortunately, he was okay during the later in the season, but playing LSU and Auburn, especially at their place, is brutal, man. It's brutal. But then again, I don't expect people to feel sorry because we're Alabama, right, which, you know, I don't, you know, really care, you know, if we get any sympathy, but hopefully we'll come out on top with no injuries. But, yeah, I'm, to answer your question, I'm a little nervous.
Yeah, you know, and you mentioned, like, every time you play LSU and Auburn, it seems like you don't show up or whatever. You see this a lot of times in big rivalry games, right? And there's an expression, and I think this expression gets overused a little bit, but they say, in a rivalry game, you can throw the records out the window. Well, I mean, I don't think that's totally true, but you do see this from time to time where in a rivalry game, the team that's considered not nearly as good plays out of their mind sometimes and either wins or keeps it close with a team that you thought would run away with it or whatever. I'm curious to see Tua play against LSU's defensive secondary, because I think they are really, really good. In the national title game, I know that was Tua's first game, and all anybody remembers is his last pass. But he struggled some in that game against Georgia's secondary. He got sacked a few times. He was running around a lot. So he really hasn't played a team anywhere near that level since then. But he will this Saturday. So we'll see. The 25 touchdowns and no interceptions thing is unbelievable. I saw a thing the other day, and I don't think I've mentioned this on Lutu because I just didn't want to admit it, but I saw a thing the other day that it was a graph or a chart, and it took the last six quarterbacks that had won the Heisman Trophy, and it had the combined stats of those six quarterbacks' six best games of that season versus Tua's first six games of this season. And Tua was ahead in every single category. That's unbelievable. That's unreal. The last six Heisman Trophy winners, you take their six best games and put them against Tua's first six starts of his career, and Tua's stats were better in every single category. Touchdowns, interceptions, yards, completion percentage, QBR, everything, Tua was ahead. I mean, that's unbelievable.
Man, it's like you said before. Come this Saturday, I'm not trying to jinx, you know, my own team and be cocky. I'm confident, but I'm not trying to be, you know, cocky. But come this Saturday, you know, all that stuff, all those statistics, all those, you know, those little trash talk schemes, those little mind guys, all that goes out the window, man. You just got to let them boys play. But that statistic is I didn't even know that statistic, and that's, like, really crazy.
Yeah.
And Tua is the type of player, you know, I don't care, you know, what team you're for, or even if you're a college foot, you have to tune in to watch this kid throw the ball.
Like, I agree.
That unbelievable.
I agree. I talk about that all the time. I loved watching Saquon Barkley play last year. I still like watching Jonathan Taylor play, even though he can't hold on to the ball. It's even fun to watch Kyler Murray play. Now, he's not having as good of a year as Tua, but if there was no such thing as Tua, people would be talking about what an amazing year Kyler Murray is having, and he would probably be the Heisman front runner if it weren't for Tua. I mean, so if you're a fan of college football, yeah, you're going to have your favorite team. But like you said, there's certain players that you just watch them and you're just, I mean, you can't help but admire what they're doing. And what Tua's doing is just unreal. And if he throws for, I mean, he doesn't even have to be ridiculous. If he throws for 250 yards, three touchdowns, and no interceptions this Saturday and Alabama wins, it's a lock for the Heisman. You can forget it. It's over.
Man, I will say this. You know, Bama, you – the games that I usually watch or see or pay attention to, really, you know, they start slow off during these games. But it seems like this season, I mean, they're just, you know, the first play, second play, you know, it's, I mean, I think, what, Missouri or Arkansas. I don't know. It only took Bama 23 seconds to score a touchdown. So it's like, before I could sit down and grab me a beer, you know, they already scored 7 points. I'm like, what the hell happened? I didn't even get out the shower, shave my face. I didn't even sit down to watch it yet.
Alabama's 8-0.
Watch those kids play is ridiculous, man.
Yeah.
And I enjoy the heck out of it.
Alabama's 8-0. They've scored a touchdown on their opening drive in all 8 games, and their average time of possession on their first scoring drive is like 57 seconds. I mean, it's unbelievable.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
But, you know, all that talk goes out the window this Saturday. You know, to LSU fans, you know, that are listening in or not listening in, you know, good luck. You know, hopefully no injuries. And I wish, you know, their linebacker, I think it was their linebacker. I don't know if it was some person on defense. But, you know, I wish he didn't, you know, get that targeting call or whatever, because, I mean, we want that competition. Bama
right.
wants that competition, you know. And I'm pretty sure, like myself, you know, don't get me wrong, I'm glad, and I'll admit it, Uncle Luke. I'd rather play, you know, Louisiana Lafayette. I'd rather play those easy games. I don't want to play Oklahoma. I don't want to play Georgia. I don't want to play LSU. I could play Auburn this year. But, you know, I don't want to play those tough teams or whatever just because it'll be harder to get to the championship. I want the easy ride. But these games, this is what makes these games so enjoyable.
Yeah.
Because you're done with all those easy games. Now's where you either put up or shut up, and we're about to find out Saturday.
That's it. Thanks for the call, Ryan. I appreciate it. I'm going to let you go. Hard to say anything bad about Bama's the opposite of Kentucky, right? Kentucky elite defense, can't play offense. Bama offense looks unstoppable, but you got no defense. let me see about these super chats that came in before I jump back on the phone here. Where'd we leave off? Waikiki, good morning, sir. Good to see you on here. The first top poll was a joke. Kentucky and Washington State are not top 10 teams. I'm not a Notre Dame fan, but they should be higher. I agree. Notre Dame should have been higher. Notre Dame should have been number 2, in my opinion. And I think I think a case could be made to put Notre Dame at number 1. I mean, Notre Dame's got the same record as Alabama. Who has a better win? Notre Dame. Notre Dame's got the best win of any team in football. Notre Dame's win over Michigan right now is the best win in college football. Washington State, I don't really know I have to admit I haven't watched a lot of Washington State this year. They snuck up on me. Before I even realized what was going on, Washington State was 6-1. So I need to watch a Washington State game to really form an accurate opinion on them, but I'm not a believer in the Pac-12 at all, so I tend to believe that probably any team in the top 15 could beat Washington State, but I need to watch them play. And I agree with you also that Kentucky should not be in the top 10. West Virginia should have been in the top 10 in my mind. And thank you for the donation, sir. Joey Foster, thank you for the Super Chat donation, sir. He says, go Mountaineers, winning the Big 12. May not make the playoffs, but maybe Notre Dame will lose Saturday when the Big 12 is in, I think. I think if West Virginia wins out, that would give them a win over a good Texas team, a win over a really good Oklahoma team, and then another win over either Texas or Oklahoma. I think the Big 12 will have a legitimate argument to make. I think it's going to come down. The committee is going to have to decide. If that happened, the committee is going to have to decide who deserves it more, a one-loss Big 12 team or a one-loss Big 10 team. That's going to be a tough decision for them to make. Chris Wallace, thank you, sir. $10 Super Chat. $10, that's on next year, Florida versus Georgia. If Florida wins, you drink $10 worth of Gatorade on video. I will do that, sir. That's fair. If Florida wins next year, and I don't drink Gatorade either, just for the record, I won't even let Lou Jr. drink it. I'm making buy Powerade, or make him drink Powerade. But that's fair, and that's something fun to do. So you'll have to probably remind me, and the rest of you too that happen to be watching right now or whatever, help remind me, because I'm not gonna lie, my memory not so good. That's what happens when your head goes through a windshield. Y'all are going to have to remind me, though, and probably even in addition to that as well, when it gets that time next year, you're going to have to remind me about this $10 worth of Gatorade thing. But that's actually a good idea. Those are the types of bets, or I don't even know if bet's the right word, but those are the types of, bet, yeah, that I like to make on college football games. I made a bet on the Georgia-Florida game when I first started this channel back in 2013 or 14. on the Georgia-Florida game. If Georgia lost, I had to eat a ghost pepper burger. And Uncle Lou does not like hot or spicy foods. Like, I love chicken wings, but I get mild. I don't even like medium. I mean, I can eat medium. I'm not trying to say that's too hot, but I get mild. I like mild. And this guy, man, in fact, I used to have, hold on a second. I had to eat a hamburger. Now, he marinated the hamburger in this ghost pepper sauce. Half the bottle was a marinade. So the hamburger marinated in that sauce, and then he grilled it. And then I wasn't allowed to have anything on it except the bun, the burger, and instead of ketchup or whatever, it was the other half of this bottle on the hamburger, and I had to eat it. And I'm telling you, it was really, really bad. I mean, I was crying the whole time. Not crying, but like my eyes were, it looked like I was crying. My eyes were watering so bad. And the taste was awful. But I'm telling you, for the next 2 days, I could not leave the house. My stomach hurt so bad. The whole inside of my neck, it felt like somebody was holding a lighter on in the inside. I mean, I don't know. If you guys have ever had any of that type of sauce, there's probably even stuff hotter, I don't know, but that was the worst. But the Gatorade point is, those are fun types of bets to do to me. So yes, I will take you up on your offer, sir. Thank you for the donation. I will drink the Haterade, Gatorade if Georgia loses. Good morning, you're on with Uncle Lou, though.
Hey, Uncle Lou, I can't stand it, Uncle Lou. These Oklahoma fans. I mean, it's one thing, college football is a little trash talk. They just completely just drag Georgia name through the dirt like they got an elite team. Defense is terrible. I mean, the Big 12 is trash this year. Texas just lost again. West Virginia's going to lose. I don't know what's going on with these. I don't know what's going on with these Oklahoma fans.
Well, I don't know either. And I see the same types of things. I mean, their defense, I mean, that's great that they fired Stoops or whatever, and they're all excited about that, but I don't know. I mean, that's no magic cure. Their offense, I think, is good, but it's not as good as it was last year. So their defense, let's say their defense is the same. It's definitely not any better, but let's say it's the same. Their offense is not as good. They're not winning the national title this year, and I hear a lot of them talking that way. I do think they have a shot to win the Big 12, although right now it looks to me like West Virginia is playing better, and West Virginia's got a legitimate defense. I mean, not top 10 or 15 or anything, but way better than Oklahoma.
Their defense is way better than Oklahoma. I just never saw they fired Stoops, right? You're thinking, maybe some improvement, but they go against whatchamacallit, and they still put them 20 points on you. I mean, your defense is trash. They're not making it to the playoffs. We'll just forget about that. And, just Oklahoma, I'm not really sure. They just wanted to find some type of defensive coordinator next season. Maybe they can do it next season, but I don't see it this season, Luke. And I just feel like these Kentucky fans are saying, this is the biggest game they had in years. I mean, just watch when Georgia just go up there to Lexington and just put 40 points on their head. I believe Georgia will score 40. I believe it's like 40 to maybe 17 or something like that. South Carolina. I believe Georgia just rose in that game, and we just go up there and just run the ball down their throat and just completely just smash their heads against the wall, Luke. I don't see Kentucky winning this game. The offense is just one-dimensional. Quarterback is trash. I mean, Benny Snell is the Kerryon Johnson of this year. I'm tired of hearing saying, I'm tired of people making this game bigger than it is, Luke. You ask me.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at Georgia and where they've had trouble this year, it's been in the first halves of games. And let's just assume, for the sake of argument, the crowd's going to be going nuts. Kentucky's going to be fired up. Let's say Kentucky comes out, we come out, and we play a bad first half like we have four or five times this year. Kentucky doesn't have the offense to take advantage of that. They don't. Like, I think Georgia could play. I think Georgia could play the worst half of football they've played all year, and at worst, be down 10 to 14 points at halftime. And I like Kirby in the second half of big games. Generally speaking, somebody's probably in the process of typing something right now. But generally speaking, Kirby makes good adjustments at halftime. Going back to last year. In some games. So even if things go absolutely right for Kentucky and absolutely wrong for Georgia in the first half, I just don't see a way where Georgia could be down more than 10 to 14 points in that game, even if everything goes bad. And I trust Kirby and Georgia in the second half to come back from that. Now, I don't think that's going to happen. I think the switch went off at LSU just like it did at Auburn last year. And I think we're going to be a different team from here on out than we were the first 6 weeks of the season. And I'm with you. I don't think this game will be close, and I think Georgia probably wins it by about 3 touchdowns. I hope I'm right. And Kentucky fans can take it as disrespect if they want. I'm not trash talking right now. I have no respect for Kentucky's offense at all. I don't. Benny Snell's a good running back, but he's not great. And here's some more breaking news for Kentucky. That's awesome that Benny Snell has however many yards he has while he's running the ball 30 times a game. Who do you think has more total rushing yards, Georgia or Kentucky?
Georgia.
So that's great that you have a wore-out Benny Snell in November, okay, that's been getting 35 carries a game. We have a Holyfield and Swift who haven't even broke a sweat yet this year. I mean, these guys are lucky if they get 8 or 9 carries a game up until the Florida game, and they had a few more. But still, nowhere near the 20, 25, and 30 that Benny Snell's been getting. So we've got 2 healthy running backs versus Kentucky's wore-out running back, and we're a team that already averages more rushing yards per game than Kentucky does anyway. Kentucky has a quarterback that can't complete passes. Fromm's hitting his stride at just the right time. It just doesn't look good for Kentucky right now, in my opinion. This thing was at 9.5 points this morning. I said on the video, if you're a betting-type person, you should be putting everything you own. Well, I don't want to tell them, people will do it and be mad at me, but I would take $1 and bet it on Georgia at -9.5. Anything under 10 points, in my opinion, is free money.
Okay, I can give you a scenario. Okay, let's say Georgia win the East, right? Now, he probably is. Kentucky's not, like I said, rolling that game. We're going to win the East, and then I think LSU going to pull up an upset to beat Alabama. And we go against Alabama and that championship. You think Georgia's going to be more prepared to go against LSU like he was last year against Auburn?
I think we would beat LSU if we played again, yes.
I think
it would be a good game. I think it would be a good game, but I based on what I saw happen last year and based on what I've seen this year since the LSU game, I believe I'll tell you this. There's no way Georgia would lose to LSU 36-16 if they play in the SEC title. No way. And it wouldn't surprise me, to be honest, if that's what ends up happening, it wouldn't surprise me at all to see Georgia favored in the SEC title game. Because I'm not the only one that thinks that LSU game was not a fluke, but a lot like the Auburn game last year. LSU just wasn't losing that day.
Washington State should get some respect. They is 7-1.
The problem is they've beat up on a terrible Pac-12, and their non-conference schedule is people make fun of like the SEC's non-conference schedule or whatever. Look at Washington State's non-conference schedule. It's pitiful. It's beyond sad. They've literally played nobody in the non-conference. So I don't think they deserve to be in the top 10.
I can see you on that. I mean, I don't think their schedule is that impressive, but I mean, it did kind of knock off Oregon. Some people was high on Oregon, saying they was probably going to win a Big 12. I mean, it's a Pac-12, but
Oregon's got 2 or 3 losses. Washington's got 2 or 3 losses. Southern Cal's got 4 losses. Neither one of the Arizona schools are any good. Bryce Love's terrible all of a sudden. Stanford can't win a game. I mean, what if I told you in August that the two best teams in the Pac-12 were going to be Utah and Washington State? I would have got laughed off of YouTube.
You probably would. Where is Lance and Jasper? Where is he at?
I got to give him some credit. I clowned him a little bit in my post-game video. He did make a video after the Florida game. Of course, it was riddled with excuses about how such-and-such player was injured and wait till next year and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. You know, it's typical Lance crap. But at least he made a video. Now, yeah. I'll be surprised if we see him anymore, though, because this is what he did last year. Loudmouth, called in Feinbaum every day, blah, blah, blah. And as soon as Georgia beat Florida, you didn't hear from that guy again until it was time to start talking about 2018. Now that Florida's season is over, it wouldn't surprise me at all if that guy disappears.
I wouldn't be surprised either. Yeah. Thanks for having me on the show.
Here. All right, thanks for the call. I appreciate it. Yeah, you're good people. Good people also in two. Yeah. Hope I don't have to drink that Gatorade, though. I don't think I will. McElwain's better than Mullen. Florida downgraded. Good morning. You're on with Uncle Lou.
Hello?
Yeah, good morning.
I just want to say Kentucky is going to beat Georgia.
Well, no, they're not. Kentucky's going to beat Georgia. No. Listen. Kentucky and Georgia could play three times. Kentucky wouldn't score enough points combined in those three games to even beat Georgia once, sir. You have no offense. None. Zero. You started off the season as a one-man band. That one man done packed his shit up and went home, dude. You got no offense. None. Zero.
Benny Snell.
Benny Snell's got a busted radiator, dude, and two flat tires, 60 yards against Missouri. Y'all wore him out, which is what I told you 3 or 4 weeks ago. You run the guy 25, 30 times a game, that don't work in the SEC. Ask Gus Malzahn about that. He ruined Kerryon Johnson and Cam Pettaway doing that in back-to-back years, and now Stoops has ruined Benny Snell. You run the ball 25 or 30 times a game, that's great in September, not so great in November.
All right, then, but who's going to block off Josh Allen, though?
Nobody. Josh Allen's unblockable.
Exactly. Yeah. We're going to get ultimate. We're going to get so many defensive stops, it's going to be crazy. Nobody. Josh
Allen's right.
What about Cash Daniels?
I mean, you guys will. I mean, we could return a punt and win this game 7-0. I mean, you guys have no off. I mean, I don't understand. I mean, I get it. You're a Kentucky fan. First time you've ever been watching football in the month of November, so I don't blame you for being excited. But Georgia's coming up there, and they're just gonna—I mean—they're gonna rip your heart out while it's still beating and feed it to you. I mean, this game is already over, sir.
Well, Terry Wilson—he's figured out he can throw, so that's what we're gonna start doing.
Yeah, well, he's got more interceptions. He's got more interceptions than he does touchdowns. So I pray to God you guys throw the ball with Terry Wilson. I pray to God you do. He'll have more interceptions than he has completions in this game. If he has, if Terry Wilson throws the ball 10 times, he'll have 5 interceptions.
Well, I just want to know how come Georgia took the Alabama then last year if they're the best team in the world?
Who said Georgia was the best team in the world? It doesn't take the best team in the world to beat Kentucky, sir.
You hype Georgia up all the time. I watch.
Yeah, and they went 13-2 last year, and they're 7-1 this year, and they beat you 8 years in a row. So it doesn't – I mean, what does Alabama have to do with Georgia beating Kentucky, sir? That's retarded and ridiculous. You don't have to be an elite team to beat Kentucky.
I'm just saying.
I mean, are you – why are you bringing up Alabama, sir? I mean, are you oiling up your saddle? You jump on them Bama nuts now? What are you doing? Are you an Alabama fan or a Kentucky fan? I mean,
Kentucky's gonna whip your ass. It's all
am right. Am I supposed to be talking to you about how great Texas A&M is because they beat you? I could give two hoots or a holler about Texas A&M. You know why? I don't care if they beat you because Georgia's beating you. So, and if you really thought Kentucky was beating Georgia, you wouldn't need to talk about Alabama. So, I mean, hashtag you tried. I know you guys are new at this, but you got to step this up. You got to step this up. You can't call in and try to trash talk me as a Kentucky fan and bring up Alabama from last year. What? How is it embarrassing to lose by 3 points in the national title game? Kentucky hasn't. I mean, the last time Kentucky even won the SEC. Well, let me think of another funny analogy I've done used. Which ones have I used? The last time Kentucky was in this position, Michael Jackson was black. The last time Kentucky had a chance to win the SEC, the Challenger exploded. I mean, what else can, how far back do we need to go here? What time is it? 11:15, 307 people watching? How many likes does this video have? Now, see, y'all done got me riled up. Now you're going to get me talking about likes. I'm going to pull it up now. I hope this doesn't happen. It'll make me mad again, ain't it? What is this? What is this now? Hush. 75? Uh-uh. I'll keep the show going, but it better get up about 150 likes in a hurry. When I end this phone call, we need to have 150 likes on this video. What are y'all doing? Y'all are killing me. Good morning, y'all with Uncle Lou. All right, hey, when you call in, you gotta listen to the phone when you call in. You can't watch YouTube while you're calling in. YouTube is on a delay. So I tried to answer the phone, but this guy's 8, 9, 10 seconds behind because he's watching on his phone. You can't watch on YouTube when you call in. You gotta listen on your phone. That's just what it is. Nothing I can do about that. It's a YouTube delay. Good morning, and two. This is Uncle Lou.
Hey, good morning, Uncle Lou. How's it going?
Oh, man. It was going good, man. What are you going to do? What are you going to do to me? What are you doing to me? What is it now? I already know, man. I can tell. I hear that raspy little thing in your voice, and I already know you got your troll cape on. So what is it today, sir?
No, I honestly did not have my troll cape on today. Anything quite the opposite. I mean, I just wanted to touch really quickly on what's going on or what we've got going on at Ohio State right now.
Better be a coaching search. That's what you better have going on. You better have a coaching search going on, or are you just going to promote Ryan Day like I told you last week?
I don't really know.
You know he's gone, man. Are you going to? All right, listen, let's do this. No, I'm not gonna. I'm not gonna bet because you won't. You'll never pay. You know he's gone. You know Urban Meyer is gone, man. Let me. I want to hear you say it. I want to hear you say Uncle Lou was right.
No, I don't know if he's gone or not. No one knows right now.
Did you see his press conference?
It's not looking good. I'll agree with you on that.
I plan on coaching next year at Ohio State. Hush mouth. He didn't say nothing. I plan on coaching Urban. There's a lot of rumors that and what's he saying now? Hey, now he's got headaches now caused by a brain cyst now. Did you hear this one now?
Remember before the year started, this was the same thing all you SEC fans were saying. Oh, Urban Meyer's gone. He's not going to come back. He's going to get fired. What happened? He came back.
Who said he was getting fired before? For what? When?
For this whole little, like, domestic violence thing that everyone said was going on.
Oh, yeah, he's done. He's gone. Yeah, I told you, this is last year, man. He's gone.
This whole witch hunt case.
Yeah. Yeah. And he's gone.
Everyone was saying he was gone.
Yeah, and he's gone.
And he came back.
No, he didn't. No, for this year. This happened this year.
What do you mean?
I mean, that was this year. I mean, like, did he get fired in August or September? No, but this is last year, though, because of that.
Okay, well.
I mean, all this is made up about the headaches and the brain cyst to cover up for him deleting those text messages, man. I mean, anybody that didn't see this coming from a mile away has got a serious case of the Ray Charleses. I mean, that's all this is. This is the same thing he did at Florida, man. As soon as it started crumbling at Florida, he had all kinds of doctor's notes. Now, there wasn't a thing wrong with him in the world a week before. Then the sky starts falling at Florida. These stories start coming out about all these gang members he had recruited and all this. And all of a sudden, he's got a million doctor's notes. Now, here we go covering up domestic abuse at Ohio State. They do an investigation. Where's all these text messages? Oh, I got memory problems. I deleted them, and I got memory issues. They said memory issues? You a head coach of a major university, one of the top 5 or 10 football programs in America, and you got memory issues? Yeah, here's a doctor's note, brain cyst. I mean, this is insane.
Well, how do you, how do you know that he doesn't have these brain cysts?
I 100% believe him. Who else would start JT Barrett for 8 years in a row? You must have a brain cyst.
JT Barrett was a fierce competitor.
Huh? A fierce competitor? So was Rudy. That's the same kind of crap they say about Rudy.
Who is Rudy? Oh, Rudy. Oh,
yeah. I guess in 20 years there'll be a JT Barrett movie. I don't know.
Here's the thing, I think, look at what we've got going on with Haskins right now. Haskins, complete opposite. He's got all the talent in the world, but he shows no emotion.
He sure did look good the first three games of the year, though.
He doesn't motivate our team to get better throughout the year. I mean, look at...
Neither does Urban Meyer. Neither does Urban... Man, look, your team don't even want Urban Meyer, man. I don't know. Is this breaking news to you? They want Ryan Day back, man. Why was the team better the first 3 weeks than they are now? The team ain't playing for Urban Meyer, man. They want this guy gone. There's no bunch of 19-year-old kids want to be looking up at this guy covering up for wife beaters and everything and whatnot.
The first 3 weeks of the season, we weren't playing anyone, to be honest. TCU turned out to not be that good, so that's why we're playing better the first 3 weeks of the season.
Now, when I said that, I was an idiot who didn't know what I was talking about, and you said Oregon State and TCU were good.
No, I never said Oregon State was good. I thought TCU.
No, by you, I mean Sucknut. Listen, when you call in, you are Ohio State fan. You're all of them. When you call in, you're the you're the representation. When you call in, so I have to talk to you accordingly, sir. Anything any Ohio State fan has ever said, right now, it's your responsibility.
Yeah, I know. I'm kind of the right now. I know I'm I represent what you think of as an Ohio State fan. I know that. Yeah.
All right, but seriously, outlook for the rest of the season. You got to be worried about that Michigan game. I know y'all have owned them, since Y2K, but this does look like a different Michigan team, or am I wrong? I'm no Harbaugh fan. I think I like making fun of Harbaugh almost as much as I like making fun of Urban Meyer, so I'm no Harbaugh fan, but... I would pick, if they were playing tomorrow, I would pick Michigan. I know they don't play tomorrow, so we'll see what happens between now and then, but they look like a better team right now.
Yeah. One thing you have to remember is last year, after we got blown out by Iowa, we came right back and blew out Michigan State by 45 points.
This is true.
So, yeah.
Now,
we don't really know. I mean, we look horrible right now, but we could get better.
Yeah, so, I mean, look, Georgia looked horrible against LSU, and you called in and explained to me how bad Florida was going to beat us, and we see that didn't happen, so I could be wrong about the Michigan thing, too. But now, do y'all play them in the big house, or do they play you in the flip-flop?
It's in the shoe.
Oh, the shoe. My bad. I thought flip-flop.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's in the horseshoe.
Okay. Well,
so,
home field advantage, is that what they say?
Yep. We'll see what happens. But, yeah.
Man, Purdue didn't look good last week, did they?
They put up a fight against who did they play? I forgot. I know they lost, but I can't remember who they played.
They lost like 13-7, man, or something like that. They scored.
Who did they? Oh well, they were going up against. They played Michigan State.
They scored a whole year's worth of points against you. What's Michigan State like? 8-1?
5-3.
No.
But they have. You have to remember they have. They're a defensive team.
Who?
Michigan State.
Oh yeah.
Like I said, sometimes these games don't make any sense.
I agree with you there. Hell, Georgia lost to LSU. Hey, did you see the national title game?
The what?
Did you see the national title game?
Oh. Yeah.
Sometimes the better team loses on it.
Sure, huh? If that's what you want to say.
Is Purdue better than... Okay, Purdue's better than Ohio State? If you played Purdue 10 times, how many does Ohio State win?
Probably 8.
Yeah. Because y'all are the better team, right?
So you're saying if you play Alabama 10 times, you beat them 8 times.
Yeah. Last year, yeah. Last year's Georgia team versus last year's... did you watch the game? Georgia was the better team. I mean, some better team doesn't always win, man. It's all right. We don't need to rehash that. People get triggered. Let's not do that. It's 11:26, man. It's 309 people watching it. Can you imagine? Even if 10% of those people are Alabama fans, the internet will explode.
Yeah.
I mean...
All right, man. Yeah.
Who y'all play this week? I can't remember. I haven't done the top. I do my top 25. Are y'all still? I do my top 25 preview tomorrow. Y'all still in the top 25, aren't you?
Yeah, we're still in the top 10.
Okay, yeah. Then I'll be previewing Ohio State tomorrow, but I haven't looked into it yet. But who y'all playing this week though?
Nebraska.
Oh man, they just come off a big win. Scored a lot of points. They played some kind of culinary school. What was the name of it?
Bethune-Cookman.
Yeah, culinary school, ain't it?
I shouldn't have even told you, yeah.
Yeah.
Something like that.
It's got to be. You said it's a cooking school, didn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. You said it was the Bethune Cooking School. Isn't that what you said? Well, I don't care if it's a man or a woman. It's 2018, man. A man can cook.
I've honestly never heard of that.
It's 2018. It doesn't matter if it's a man or a woman. Come on. That's racist, what you just said there.
What?
That it's a man that cooks.
No, it should be the woman.
Point is, it's a culinary school, but y'all should get a win over Nebraska without a problem. Hey man, thank you for the call. Even though you get me irritated every once in a while, I do look forward to your call every week. I'd be lying if I said I didn't. So thank you for the call. I appreciate it. All right, we'll talk to you again soon. Yeah, I like that guy because that guy gets me irritated, but it's he gets me irritated and it's football related. You know, he's not one of these 7-year-olds whose mom still Velcros their shoes and wants to call up and breathe in the phone. You know, or just yell the N-word out and then hang up or something like that. That gets me irritated, too. But good morning. You're on with Uncle Lou. Yep.
What's up, Uncle Lou?
I don't know, man.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. Pretty much loud and clear, too.
This is Jay Coleman, 933. I did a couple videos for you a while back.
Yeah.
On the ball card.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. So I'm hope everyone can hear me. You guys are gonna smack Kentucky. It's not even gonna be a game.
I think so. Yeah.
Oh, I know so. It's gonna be horrible. All these Kentucky fans. Have you saw Benny Snell? He's to me, I think he's garbage.
Yeah, he wore out, ain't he?
I don't think he.
Yeah, I think he wore out.
He's not very good, but I know this is about Kentucky today. But let's talk about Tennessee for a second. What do you think? What do you think about old Jeremy Pruitt down here in Knoxville?
Well, he does nothing, has it?
Do what?
Oh, he beat Auburn.
Well, I mean that's a really bad Auburn team. So
yeah, but I mean,
know,
other
I,
than
I love my Tennessee Vols, but you know, we played a good defense against you guys, and then I really thought we were going to beat South Carolina, and we came out and we choked in South Carolina the other day. Were you able to catch that game?
Yeah, and the thing is, I'll agree with you. I gave Tennessee a chance heading into that game too. And I even said if it was at Tennessee, I would probably pick Tennessee to win it because South Carolina has been such a disappointment this year. South Carolina, not the hardest place in the world to play, but it is one of the – it's in the top half, I would say, of tough places to play in the SEC, especially at night for a pretty young team that Tennessee is, first-year coaching staff, that kind of thing. I mean, I know you're disappointed that you lost, but, I mean, most people had that game as a loss before the season started because they thought South Carolina was going to be good. Problem is now, can you win three out of your last four, though, and make a bowl game, though?
Honestly, man, I think I hate to even say it, but I.
You want me to say it?
I think we'll barely beat Charlotte. I think we'll barely beat Charlotte.
Oh, no.
I think we're going to get beat by Missouri.
No. Well, first of all, I'm pretty sure Charlotte was winless last year. I don't know what they've done this year, but they're a terrible team. You guys should. I think you guys will blow them out. I'm being serious. Well, y'all done did it now. Y'all kept me on the show too long. Now my secular phone died. Yes, I said secular phone. Separation of church and YouTube. So it's a secular phone. My phone died again. This happened last week when I tried to run the show extra. Apologize for your call, sir. I'll talk about Tennessee for a minute or two for you, though. I think y'all will blow Charlotte out. And then, of course, your three remaining games after that are Missouri, Kentucky, Vandy. I'm not going to lie. At this point, out of those three teams, Missouri is the team I give you the most chance to beat. They've been unimpressive lately. I don't know what's happened. I thought they would be better than they are this year. They've lost four of their last five games. They haven't looked good. Drew Locke, he's going to be playing. He may already be preparing for the draft or something. Maybe that's the issue. I don't know. I think it's possible Tennessee beats Kentucky. Georgia's going to ruin their season. I don't mean it that way. Kentucky will be a two-loss team after this weekend, which is really, really great for Kentucky. But I think they may be a little demoralized. Tennessee may have a chance there. Obviously, I think, you know, Kentucky's the better team. I don't think that's a surprise to anybody. But I would give Tennessee a slight chance against Kentucky. They're going to be beat up from getting whipped by Georgia. And then Vandy, I think, is 50-50. Vandy's owned you guys. I think they've won four of the last, seven? Five of the last eight, something like that. Won a couple of years in a row. Here's the problem with Tennessee. I think potentially Tennessee could beat all four of those teams. I think they're definitely beating Charlotte. I would give Tennessee a chance against Kentucky, a chance against Mizzou, and a chance against Vandy. Problem is, young team, new coaching staff, it's hard to play at a consistent level. So you got to look at it. Like, let's say you have a 50% chance of winning each of those three games. That means you probably win one of them. Maybe two. If you win two, it'd be great. When you go bowling, we're sitting at three wins. How many wins does Tennessee even have? It is three, isn't it? The barn and two non-con games. I think that's right. Yeah, three. So you need three more. I had you at 5-7 in the preseason. Tennessee fans really want to make a bowl game. Here's why a bowl game matters. Because I know some Tennessee fans say, who cares, we'll go to some, you know, the Walmart Bowl or whatever it is, played in this, you know, 2 weeks before Christmas. Who cares? It's the extra practice. That's what it is. If you don't make a bowl game, your season ends the last day of the season. You can't practice after that. You can't practice just to practice. I mean, the NCAA has rules on these things. If you make a bowl game, obviously you're allowed to practice leading up to the bowl game. So the further out your bowl game is, the longer you get to practice. So that's where making a bowl game would benefit Tennessee. Yeah, it would be a really bad bowl game. You'd make a couple hundred thousand dollars to go towards Butch Jones' buyout, which would be great, I guess, or to go towards Jeremy Pruitt's buyout 2 or 3 years down the road. But the main thing would be the extra practices they would get. So, I it'd be ideal for Tennessee to make a bowl game. I just think it's going to be hard for them to get there. But we'll see. What's up in the comments section? Let me shout out everybody that donated in the Super Chat, too. Bethune-Cookman is a black school from Florida. Now, that's definitely racist, because I've known white people that have cooked. So I don't understand. The other guy said it's just not making any sense here about this culinary school. But thank you for the donation, sir. Shout out to Florida B. Shout out to Chris Wallace, Joey Foster, Waikiki, Chris Wallace again, Tomahawk 238, Seth Stein, Chris Wallace, Florida B, and Gator Zoned. Thank you guys for supporting the channel. It really means a lot. Thank you very, very much for the super chat and the donation. I appreciate it. We had a lot of viewers on here tonight, guys, so thank y'all. I really appreciate it. At one point, it was up close to 350 people watching, which is a whole... I know it doesn't seem, might not seem like a lot. You look at like my videos and they get thousands and thousands of views or whatever, but that's an uploaded video. When it comes to a live video, getting 350 people to watch live, that's a lot of people. That's got to be 350 is close to the... It's got to be close to the most I've ever had other than the times I've live streamed end of games. Like I live streamed the end of the Rose Bowl. There was, I think, 40,000 people watching that live at one point, just watching. It wasn't even the game. It was just me screaming at the TV at the end of the Rose Bowl. Same thing for the national title game. Anyway, I've done that 3 or 4 times. So you get a lot of people to watch that. But for one of these call-in shows that we do, 350, if it's not the most we've ever had, it's very, very close. So really appreciate you guys watching, and I did check the thumbs up, and you guys came through like the bosses that you are. It was at 160-something when I looked, so thank you. I'll just mention it again, but YouTube uses all these weird algorithms to determine where they place videos in their feed of videos within YouTube, and one of the big things that factors into how high up that list a video gets pushed is the number of thumbs up that it gets. So if you're a troll and you hate Uncle Lou, that's where the thumbs down really sucks, because the thumbs down push the video down the list, allowing less people to find the video. The thumbs up pushes the video up the list, making it available to a lot more people. So I don't know why I told you that about the thumbs down. Some of you probably already knew that anyway. All the trolls now be thumbs down in every one of my videos, and my views will get cut in half, and I'll have to start eating Wish sandwiches instead of bologna sandwiches. Any of you guys ever had a Wish sandwich? You ever been so bad off you had to eat a Wish sandwich? A Wish sandwich will make you wish you had some bologna, is what it is. But a Wish sandwich is when you wish you had something to put between the two pieces of bread, but you don't, so you just wish you did. Anyway, yeah, thank you, Taylor. Why do they mistreating Uncle Lou? Where is that? Is that on here? It's got to be on here somewhere. I got too many of these things now, and now I can't find, now I can never find the one I'm looking for. Where is this one now? That's not, there it is.
Stop mistreating Uncle Lou!
I got so many of these things now, I can't never find the one I'm looking for. Shout out to everybody in the comments section. It's still here. 279 people still here. David Heath, Pharma Gangsta 1, Mr. Lambo 446, Two Diesel, good morning. Paul Warren, Preston Kelly, Mary Populous, good morning. Luke Joles, good morning. Happy Halloween to you too, sir. Thank you. Tim A, NCIS Fanatic, Gary Barbie, Backdoor Bubba Brown. He leaves some of the best comments on all of YouTube. Cousin Big Dog, Mike Reiser, R. Gannon, Big C, Gracious, Paul Warren, Shot Kills, Hot Crosby, Rick Talley, Nicholas Thompson, Jonathan Hardaway, Blackhawk Central, HTTR. Hey, good morning, sir. Any of you guys are NFL fans, check out his channel. I assume you're still making videos, sir, but he's a Redskins fan, makes a lot of NFL videos. Y'all check him out. Troy Moses, good morning. Mr. Lambeau 446, SSL, Tomahawk 238, Oscar S. Gary Barbie says, Uncle Lou, I live in Evans too. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, I grew up in Richmond County, but I live out in Evans now. So, yeah, I like it out here. I have kids. It's a better school zone out here now than when I was a kid. Richmond County wasn't that bad. Well, Penn, we're in Richmond County, but I was on the west side. I went to West Side High School, so it was good back then. Probably maybe still good now. I don't know, but Columbia County, better school zone, so I moved out here. Atomic Owen, good morning. Florida Ben? Is that the same one and he just changed his name? He was B-I-H, or is that a new one? I don't know. Can't keep up with you guys. Change your name all the time on me. Jay Bolton, good morning. Mark Dudley, what's up, buddy? Michigan going to beat Ohio State this year, Mark Dudley. I need you to let me know, man, before I go full bore on these Ohio State fans. Mockster 03, good morning. Rob DeGoat, Blake Wynn, Paul Warren, Jeremy Coleman, good morning. Yeah, that was my phone that died, Jeremy. I'm sorry about that. The same thing happened last week. It's my fault. I didn't charge my phone enough in time before. I usually do these shows for an hour, and I know about how much battery I need for that. I've been gone. Our Lou Jr. had a soccer game. I wasn't home. Charged phone, blah, blah, blah. Excuse. I sound like a Florida fan after a loss with all these excuses about why my phone died. But point is, phone died in the middle of the call with you, so sorry about that. Buddy M, good morning. Joey Foster, Mike Reiser, Kev Morrow. Jersey Bear. What if Kentucky beats Bama and Georgia? Cameron Swain, good morning. Prince 6'1", good morning. JoJo Bugs, Trey Bosley, Tram Dickerson, Steven Reddish, Lou, Steven, Wild Dog, Tim A. Elite Vol fan. Not a regular Vol fan. That's the elite one right there. That's the Vol fan that all the other Vol fans aspire to be. The elite Vol fan. Squid Tard. Whee! How in the hell? KP Dog. Good morning, sir. Richard Neal. Good fella. What if LSU beats him first? Goose Flowers. Colby Stone. McGoffin fan says, go Kentucky. What is a McGoffin? McGoffin fan 24. Does that mean you're a fan of McGoffin? And what is McGoffin? Some things are better left unknown. Connor Jackson, Uncle Lou, you can't deny we have the better matchups in the Georgia game. No, you don't. You have a good defense. You're not going to shut Georgia out. Your offense is terrible. Pathetic. Three touchdowns in your last three games. I don't get it. Georgia rushes for more yards per game than you do. Say what you want about Jake Fromm, and Lord knows I've said plenty. He's 100 times the quarterback Terry Wilson is. Will you get some yards on the ground with Benny Snell and touchdown Terry Wilson? Yeah, you will. Will it be enough? No, it won't. Is Georgia going to score in the 40s in this game? Probably not. Your defense is really, really good. You're not scoring 20. I think 16 points is the most you've scored in your last three games. It's just not happening for you. Still a good year for Kentucky, though, especially if you went out and go 10-2. Even if you lose one more and go 9-3, still a good year. You win a bowl game, you're sitting at 10-3. So still a good year, but you just not beating Georgia. Taylor says 17-7. I mean, that's a realistic looking score. I mean, especially if if Fromm struggles, then I could. This is going to be a tight, low scoring game, because if we become run dimensional and have to try to run the ball, then this could be a tight, low-scoring game. If Fromm's able to throw the ball, if we're able to protect him at all, and that's not going to be easy to do against Josh Allen and company, then I think Georgia wins this game by three scores plus. Paul Warren says Georgia 45, Kentucky 7. I know Tennessee fans hate Kentucky. That's big rivalry there. What's the key for Georgia to keep Fields next year? I don't know. I really thought we needed to play him this year and let him actually be a quarterback. We didn't do that. Even when we did put him in, it was a bunch of handoffs and stuff like that. And I really think we messed up how we used Justin Fields this year. I never want to lose anybody to transfer. But if Justin Fields decides he wants to transfer, it's hard to be mad at him after the way we used him this year, in my opinion. We've let him throw the ball 9 times against Power 5 teams. It just doesn't make any sense to me. Fields to West Virginia. I heard Florida State, but, I mean, that means nothing at this point. I would assume he would enroll in January at UGA, go through spring practice and see what happens. And maybe the coach comes to him and says it's going to be Fromm's team again, and he then can transfer and enroll somewhere for the fall semester, red shirt, and then play in 2020. I don't know. I have no idea. We got plenty of time to talk about that after the season ends. I'm really over all that right now. I told Georgia fans, just forget about Fields for the rest of this year. Forget it. I mean, he didn't play a single snap in the Florida game. Just forget about Fields. It's Jake Fromm's team. Just forget about it. Lou, did you unblock my number? No, I didn't. Give me the last 4 again, because I don't know where that piece of paper is that I wrote it down last time, and I'll try to remember to do it this time. Just type the last 4 in there. Can't you download a phone app and get yourself a different number to call in? That would be easier. That's what I do. That's what this number is. The 510-6817, that's not my cell phone number. That's just an app that gives me a fake number for y'all to call. 8851. I mean, you could easily do that too and then call in, but I will try to get around. My phone's dead. I can't do it right now. So it's the same thing that happened last time, I think. I'll try to get around to remembering. I mean, I don't even know how to unblock a number that's blocked, but I'll try to get around to doing it. But if it doesn't work, then it's just going to be your responsibility to figure out another way to call in. Doesn't matter. Just because. Why is Blake Wynn saying 8851? Who the hell is Blake Wynn? I don't even know. Paul Johnson runs this state. yeah, I love Paul Johnson. I hope he gets a lifetime contract at Georgia Tech. Hope to keep him forever. How much will Zeus play next year? Way too early to be asking that question. The guy's in a wheelchair, or not a wheel, whatever, crutches. He's 2 months out of knee surgery again on the opposite knee as last time. So I don't know. And I hate that because I haven't been as excited about a recruit, I don't think, ever as I was about Zamir White. I think he had the potential to be one of the best running backs Georgia's ever had. And hard to come back from a knee injury. Very hard to come back from 2 knee injuries. So we'll see. I'm hoping for the best for him. John Neal, first time I've watched him, a big Catfish fan. I love Catfish, yeah. Yeah, we're good friends, me and Catfish. I mean, I've never met him, but we're as much of friends as you can be without actually meeting somebody, I guess. But we talked on the phone. We message back and forth all the time. He's a good guy. He's a much nicer guy than I am. That's for sure. But yeah, I like him a lot. I hated that that accident he got into, and. The people in that you're with right now in the comment section really did a lot to help him out in that accident with that GoFundMe that we had. I was surprised how much money that thing raised. You should watch YouTube every day because it makes you smarter and lowers your cholesterol. Yeah, I should put that on a T-shirt. Why don't you show the comment in the live videos anymore, like on the side of the video. Well, two reasons. One, YouTube changed the way they replay live videos on YouTube now. So once I end this live stream and this video gets uploaded to YouTube, it plays the live comments. It didn't used to do that. It used to be that once the video ended, you couldn't reread the live comments. They were gone. And so that's why I originally had them on the screen, so that you could always see the live comments even after the video was uploaded to YouTube. Now you can see the live comments after the video was uploaded. That's one reason. Number two, I think that may have had something to do with why I was having all those computer problems a month or so ago. Somebody had the suggestion. I remember when I asked you guys for suggestions on what I could do, the stream kept crashing and stuff like that. One of the suggestions that I got was to take the chat off the screen. To put the chat on the screen right now, I have to basically run a whole separate Chrome page, Internet Explorer, whatever you use. I use Chrome, and pull up the live video like I'm watching it. And then pop out the chat and add it to OBS, which is this program I use to stream. And anyway, when there's 200, 300, whatever people in the comments section, and there's this many people commenting, and the comments are scrolling that fast, it's hard, I guess, for the computer to keep up with all that. Not on YouTube, not on what you're seeing on your phone, but on my computer. Because to do a live stream on a computer like this, I mean, I have OBS, that's the program I'm streaming with. Then I have YouTube open. You have to have YouTube open to start the live stream. So then if I pop the chat out, that opens up a whole nother window. Then I got to take that window, add it to OBS. Anyway, the guy said, try not doing the live chat thing. It may be too much for the computer. So I tried that. And since then, I don't think we've had any problems. So anyway, yeah, that's why. UJ has the fourth most percentage to lose as a playoff contender. I don't even understand what that means. What would you do if UK beats Georgia? Another 40-year-old Coke, maybe. I don't know. The 40-year-old Coke thing, that's the only game reaction that I've ever pre-planned, because that was a bet I made on one of these live streams. I was so confident we were going to win. I said, if we lose, I'll drink this 40-year-old Coke. That's how confident I am that Georgia's going to win. So that's the only thing I've ever done immediately after a game that I, you know, that was arranged ahead of time or, whatever. I mean, the couple of times, I mean, the most popular one is like the TV and all that just happened. So I don't know what I would do if I have no idea what we would do. I mean, a lot of it depends on how we lose, all that kind of, you know. Some people just think now, ever since I broke that TV that time, that every time Georgia loses, I just lose my mind. And that's not necessarily true. I wasn't even really mad when we lost the national championship game. I was heartbroken. I was devastated. You know, people type 1980 in the comment section all the time. But, I mean, especially Alabama fans, I mean, they just don't get it. Not everybody's Alabama that has a chance to win a title every single year. I mean, as a Georgia fan, Georgia's had some great years the last 15 or 20 years. I mean, some great years, but no national titles. And, you know, to lose it like that, but I wasn't really mad. I mean, I didn't break anything. I didn't yell or jump around or anything. I was speechless. I don't know, a lot of you probably were watching or have seen it since then, the reaction to that Alabama game. But I mean, the losses that make me mad are like games we have no business losing. Like, it's not embarrassing to lose to Alabama. Yeah, I hate that we lost, but not embarrassing to lose in the national championship game by 3 points. I guess people think it bothers Georgia fans, but it's funny when you see like a South Carolina fan that types 1980. Like, what are you, like, bro? Tulane has more SEC titles than South Carolina, and you're typing 1980. Like, you, like, what are you doing? But anyway, yeah. So, it didn't taste as, I had looked it up on YouTube, or I would have. Now, when I said it on the stream, I was like, I'm so confident I'll drink that Coke. And then people in the comments section were like, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. If they lose, you got to drink that Coke. So I don't remember if it was right after that stream or the next day or whatever it was, but I actually looked it up, like, can you die or what? Because I didn't know. And you guys can look it up too. There's actually a lot of videos on YouTube of people drinking really old Cokes. And it doesn't taste good, but it can't hurt you. So I wasn't, you know, if I'd have looked some stuff up and it was like, no, this will, you know, your kidney will explode, or I wouldn't have drank it. I just would, you know, I would just have people in the comment section telling me I backed out of a bet or whatever. I'm saying, yeah, I backed out because I looked it up and it said my kidney would explode or whatever. So I looked it up and it said another one that would just taste bad. But, I mean, it was flat, obviously. And then, now it was 40 years old. Now, I don't know what Coke and Pepsi were supposed to taste like 40 years ago, but, like, I don't like Pepsi now because it's too sweet to me. And Coke is not as sweet to me as Pepsi. I don't know, maybe y'all taste it different, but to me, Pepsi is just a lot sweeter, and I don't like it. And that Coke, to me, tasted more like a Pepsi does today. It tasted sweeter. And I don't know if it was like that back then, or maybe if over time the saccharin or whatever it was that was in there to give it the sugar, I don't know if it gets a sweeter taste after 40 years. I don't know. And then you ever eaten maybe a stale cracker or something, and it's that little cardboardy taste or something to it. It was a little bit of that. But it wasn't really that bad. And then I had a lot of people ask me if it made me sick or anything. No, it didn't make me sick. Now, about an hour or so after I drank it, I had like a little bit of a stomach ache. But it wasn't, I don't think it was because the Coke was bad. You know, maybe, I don't know. You know, if you pop a Coke right now and guzzle it all, your stomach might hurt in an hour from all the carbonation or for whatever's in the Coke. I don't know, but no, it didn't make me sick. I was fine the next day. Caffeine-free Pepsi. I like caffeine-free Coke. I don't think I've ever had caffeine-free Pepsi, though. Shotkill says he likes dogs. Me too. So did the 1980s have the real cocaine? I know originally Coca-Cola was made with real cocaine, but I don't think the 1980 ones. I went through the Coca-Cola Museum about a year ago, and they went through all that. I think they took the cocaine out way before 1980. I could be wrong. I bought a 12-pack of vanilla Coke a couple of weeks ago because I thought maybe the kids would like it or whatever, and no one likes it. So now there's just a 12-pack of vanilla Coke in the refrigerator out here that I guess nobody's ever going to drink because I don't really like it either. I like soft tacos better than hard. I'll eat a taco salad every once in a while, which is basically a crushed up hard taco. But like when we have taco night here at home, nobody here eats hard tacos. We make soft tacos, and then Mrs. Lou eats a taco salad. And then sometimes me and Lou Jr. will eat a couple of soft tacos, and then we'll make a taco salad. But we make the taco salad, and y'all probably do this too, but we make the taco salad with Doritos. I know some people just use the tortilla chips, or some people even just take the taco shells and crush those, the hard taco shells, and crush those up. But we make the taco salad with Doritos. I drink a lot of bottled water. I started over the summer, and I'm going to continue because I was drinking way too much Coke. Gun to your head, who wins the Heisman? If they gave the Heisman out right now, Tua would win it. And I think if he has a big game against LSU, he can lock it up. If Tua goes for 250 and three touchdowns against LSU, I think the Heisman is his. Eshaun, you don't have to watch. I mean, you say you don't care about our... Someone asked about the tacos, so I answered it. So the fact that you say you don't care about the tacos, I really don't care what you care or don't care about. So let's try to keep that in mind in the future. All right, now type on that for a while. What recruit do we need? We need to hang on to Nolan Smith at this point. I mean, we still have more 5-stars committed right now than any other team. You know, everybody likes to jab at UGA right now because we lost Hasselwood and Emory, 2 5-stars. But you got to remember, we had 5 5-stars committed. The next closest team had 2. So we still have 3 5-stars. We still have more than anyone else. Or maybe we have, I think we have 3. See, 2 or 3. Anyway, we have more than anyone else, whatever the case is. You're going to make a video if Bama loses on Saturday. Of course. Yes. Yeah. I'll probably make a video after that LSU-Bama game, no matter who wins or loses. Do we have any 4- or 5-star linebackers? I hope we got some inside linebackers. I don't care if they're 4- or 5-star, but I hope we got some that are ready to play, because our inside linebackers are terrible. Natrez Patrick is pitiful. What do I think we need next year? We need defensive linemen. Kirby Smart has dropped. We had great recruiting classes, but I think we've only signed 2 or 3 defensive tackles total in the 3 years that Kirby's been here. We're thin on the defensive line. And we keep missing on our top 2 or 3 targets every single year at defensive tackle. So we need to hit gold there. This kind of pointless trolling just pisses me off, especially when I've been on here for 2 hours. And so I'm just not in the mood to put up with it. And the good news is I don't have to. You think we have a better chance to get Hasselwood or Emery to recommit? Neither. They're gone. Where's Trent Thompson stayed? When he left, I was like, well, good riddance, because he was kind of a disappointment. But after seeing what we're working with, it wouldn't hurt to have him, would it? Now, I'm not going to block all the trolls. I like the football trolls. $19.80 Bulldog beer? I'm definitely not drinking that. I'm excited about Tom Crean. I've been trying to get rid of... It took me 2 years to get rid of Mark Fox. Crazy. It took me way longer to get rid of Mark Fox than it did to get rid of Mark Richt. It only took me about 6 minutes, one video and 6 minutes to get rid of Mark Richt. It took me 2 years to get rid of Mark Fox. Good riddance. That guy was trash, man. Trash. Was at Georgia 10 years. Made the NCAA tournament once or something like that. I mean, that's pitiful. Pitiful. I don't expect Georgia to dominate in basketball, but look at the Atlanta area. And we don't even have to get the best of the Atlanta area. We get the second best of the Atlanta area. Georgia should be at least making the NCAA tournament every couple of years. I mean, that's not too much to ask. I mean, 65 teams make the NCAA tournament. Georgia should be one of the best 65 teams in America at least every couple of years. I mean, every graduating class from UGA should have the opportunity to see the basketball team play in the NCAA tournament. That's not too much to ask. I don't want, you know, people, Lou expects Georgia to be a dominant basketball team. No. I expect Georgia to make the NCAA tournament every couple of years. Mark Fox was a dead weight. Good riddance, man. That dude was terrible. Who's the best QB in the class of 2019? I'm done with the whole QB thing. I hope we get a no. I hope the next 2 quarterbacks we sign are no-name 3-stars. Who would win a fight, Gundy or Herman? I usually would bet on the person with the mullet. Because Tech runs the ball and Georgia can't stop the run. But that's not going to happen. Tech's not beating Georgia. Not worried about that. But that's why other fan bases are saying it. I really don't know. I'm not much of a recruiting guru, especially during the season. Now, I'll shift my focus to recruiting after the SEC championship game because, of course, you got early signing day now is in December. December 12th, I think it is, this year. So you have, like, only a week from the SEC championship game till the early signing day. So I'll do a bunch of recruiting stuff leading up to early signing day in December. And then I do a lot of recruiting stuff after the national championship game is played in January. I do a lot of recruiting stuff leading up to regular signing day in February. But I do so much on current players during the season that I don't really have enough time to fairly get into recruiting during the season. I mean, I keep an eye on all the big names. Like, you know, obviously I knew who John Emery was, so I was excited when he committed. I knew when he left, and you know, Nolan Smith and Hasselwood and Blaylock, and you know, I know all those guys. But as far as like getting in depth, like, you know, who's the 17th best recruit on our board or whatever, I'm not that guy. There are guys that do recruiting much more in depth and a lot better than I do, and that's usually who I get my information from, and I just regurgitate what I hear from them when it comes to the recruiting and everything like that. Waikiki, hey, like Halloween. What's the kids going to be? Thank God, Lou Jr. wanted to be a Fortnite character, my God, please no. But he changed his mind, and actually, they both changed their mind. I don't want to ruin it. I'll take pictures and put it up on Twitter and maybe even show it in a, when's Halloween, tomorrow? I'll take pictures and I'll put it at the beginning of the Thursday video and you guys can see. But I liked it. They ended up doing okay, which was good because in the beginning, it was looking not so good. When he said he wanted to be at Fortnite, oh my God, it made a Fortnite character for Halloween. Shane Bentley, thank you for the donation. Shane Bentley says, go Dogs. I appreciate that, sir. You good people. Thank you for the super chat. I appreciate it. And yeah, go Dogs. Big game this weekend. Clinch the East. All right, I'm going to wrap it up, guys. 12:06, went 2 hours tonight. Appreciate it. This kind of makes up, hopefully, for me not doing a live show tomorrow. If you weren't on in the beginning, I'm not going to do tomorrow's live show, the Wednesday 3 p.m. show. It's Halloween. My first my first kid home from school gets home at 3, and then Lou Jr. gets home at 4. Tomorrow's Halloween, so I usually do the show at 3 instead. Start her on her costume and all that kind of stuff. So and other people might, you know, other people have kids or their own thing they're doing tomorrow afternoon, tomorrow night too, or whatever. So I'm just gonna skip the live show for tomorrow, the 3 p.m. show. But that's okay because it went 2 hours tonight. And of course the live show. I will do the live show Thursday night at 10. I will do the live show Friday afternoon at 3, and Saturday morning at 9. And I'm live streaming the second half of the Kentucky game too on Saturday, but that's for Patreon members. That's just for Patreon members. So if you want to join up on the Patreon page, you can find the link in the description of this video or any video that I've posted over the last few months or whatever. It's the link that says want to win a jersey and support the channel. Click that link to take you to Patreon page. You get you signed up over there. And I'm going to live stream the second half of the my reaction to the second half of the I'm going to live stream. Oh my God. Yeah, I got to end this stream. I'm obviously too tired to be out here now. I'm going to live stream during the second half of the Georgia-Kentucky game. That's what I'm trying to say for the Patreon members. It'll be on YouTube, but it'll be a private unlisted video. The link will be posted on Patreon. Anyway, appreciate all you guys watching. Thanks again to all the super chats, all the commenters, all the phone calls. Thank you. I appreciate it. I really do. You have no idea. And don't forget.
See y'all again. Meet us at Kroger Field. Uncle Lou, meet us at Kroger Field.
Meet us at Kroger Field. Meet us at Kroger Field. All right. Thanks, guys. Y'all have a good morning.